as we begin this morning, please take a moment and fill out the connection card that can be found in your bulletin. That'll really help us get to know you a little bit better and help us identify how we can serve or pray for you. Please complete as much information as you feel comfortable sharing, and be sure to mark the box on the left-hand side that says first or second time guest if you're newly joining us. Now, if you would, please go ahead and turn the connection card over to the back side, and you'll see a number of next steps. Everywhere that we go, we are witnesses for Jesus Christ. Let me encourage you this morning, as you go about your week, please go out of your way to show Christ to those you meet. Today, we will look at Luke 7, the centurion's faith. The message is faith that gets it. William Temple said about worship, "To worship is to quicken the conscience by the holiness of God, to feed the mind with the truth of God, to purge the imagination by the beauty of God, to open the heart to the love of God, to devote the will to the purpose of God." Let's draw near to God and worship together as we stand and join in our call to worship. It's printed in your bulletin. Your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Your word is our heritage forever, the joy of our hearts. Please take your hymnal and join us on 469 as we sing to God, "Jesus is all the world to me."
Hey, I need your hymnal. What is this?
Thank you.
Let's confess our sins together as we pray the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. Patient and persistent God, we come, polished and presentable, to this comfortable room as if we knew what to expect, as if this were a safe and predictable place, as if we could simply observe. Holy One, forgive our tepid expectations. In the mystery of your love, overshadow us. Plant the seeds of your gospel in each of our hearts until we bloom and spill with your passion to serve in a world that is wasting. Amen. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The Spirit of God dwells in you. If you hear nothing else today, hear these words: there is no condemnation. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Well, my name isn't Chris, but I tell you what, he works so hard for us. He and Angie, I know, pray for us. We just pray for his health and his sustaining. We also pray at this time, in this special day, for our country, as we remember 9/11. There's 2 days that I've remembered so poignantly. One was eighth grade shop class. Over the intercom comes the announcement that John F. Kennedy was assassinated. Oh. And the other time was this one, when one of my soldiers drove up in a truck in front of the parachute shed where we were getting our parachutes ready to jump with soldiers again. I know it's crazy, but he opened the door and he turned up his radio, and we learned about the Twin Towers being attacked. So we'll pray for our nation. We'll pray for the Christians in every nation all over the world. So I would open it up now, and I'll get my pen and I'll write down the names of the people you want us to pray for today. Please, is there anyone you would like for us to pray? Yes.
Gail.
Okay. David. Okay. Thank you. Laura.
Deanne.
Okay. So David. David, how do you like... What, David. David.
Yeah.
Quinn. Daniels.
Yeah.
How do you like it looking at Laura when she's up here behind the pulpit?
That was awesome.
I did too. Thank Laura. Please, it's the first time that she did the liturgy. Please thank Laura. Please thank her. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Yes. Tim Gorham? Gorman family. Okay. Okay, John.
Jan, Heather, and Janet.
And John, thank you for you and your wife for these beautiful flowers. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I didn't arrange them.
Oh, good. Good. But you arrange a lot of stuff. Yes.
For the group of ladies from our church that have traveled to Europe to go to the Oberammergau play.
Oh, yes. Every 10 years it happens, right? Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Alex and Ingrid.
Okay. Thanks, Tom. Okay, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father, you made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We thank you, Lord, that all things work together for good to those who love you. We thank you, Lord, that our help comes from you. We thank you, Lord, that we can trust in you with all of our heart and lean not onto our own understanding, but know you, and you will direct our paths. Thank you, Lord, for the burdens that you have given our people here this day, for people to pray for, loved ones, friends. For journey mercies. For this day you've given us, this 9/11 day. Oh my gosh, Lord. We pray for all the families who are directly affected and grieving from that. We ask your blessing upon them. We ask your blessing upon our church. We ask your blessing upon your church as you move us forward. Thank you, Lord, for remembering us. May we remember you every day. Lord, move our hearts to love you more. Open our hearts to love you more. Help us, O Lord, and use the prayer that you have given us to do just that. Thank you, Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Please now let us continue our worship by opening our hymn books to number 454. Open my eyes that I may see. Please stand.
Of truth.
The peace with a squeeze and a smile. Squeeze and a smile.
Yes, make sure I'm doing it.
Well, this takes longer than you. Chap is in.
Chap is. We have Gary. Today is Chap's birthday.
Well, just go up and start.
Oh, this is Stag. Come on.
There, arrested.
$20.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear child. Happy birthday to
years. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, buddy. All right, what's the next thing we've got to do here? We got to keep on standing up. Ha, 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 ha. Please stand and we'll say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, choir, you sure you want to stay? Come on. You do double duty every Sunday. You can. I'll give you time to leave, and then I'll follow you right out. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Oh. Okay. And Helen, I need your help again. If I forget to take the offering, will you wave a dollar bill? And everybody, if you just got your doubt, like Tom and you and Ellen did that last time. Yeah, I've been known to forget the offering. So wave your dollar bills, okay? Let's have a word of prayer so that I can focus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For each and every one here. For their loved ones, for their friends, for people that you have us meet and engage every day, every week, in the seasons of the year, in the seasons of our lives. Lord, may this story of faith help us love you more. Help us love you more, Lord. We need your help in our lives to love you more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. All right, here we go. Let's talk about faith this morning. When you think of someone who lived or lives and has faith, and our Lord Jesus Christ, who do you think about? First person that comes to my mind is my grandmother, Carolyn Camp. She was just a widow lady, you know. And I remember as a little boy, I used to hold her hand. And she'd come visit us. I grew up in Miami. She'd come from Baltimore on the train to visit us. And I remember holding her hand. And she sent my brother and I Bible storybooks, Bibles. There was just something about my grandmother that attracted me to her and to the Lord. Now, you've heard of the 19/20. There's 19 people who don't know that they don't know who helped you to the Lord. And there's one person who led you to the Lord. 19 people affected your life, impacted your lives, my life. And you can think back on those people now. And they don't even know it now. But the Lord used them in your life and in my life. Oh my gosh. Think about those people now, because we're going to be talking about faith. A story about faith. Now let's approach faith from the words of Oswald Chambers. Said, it is much easier to do something than to trust in the Lord. That is why there are so few fellow workers with God and so many workers for God. We would far rather work for God than to believe in Him, because trusting God takes work. It just takes a step back and say, Lord, thank you for loving me so much to allow this to happen in our lives, in my life. I can do nothing to fix this. It's yours. Have you been there? Have you been there a lot? That's faith. Our scripture passage today is a faith story. We find Jesus, the apostles, other disciples, and tagalongs all coming and entering into Capernaum. They're heading for Peter's home because they're hungry. That's a good motivation. But before they get there, their trip gets interrupted by some worried-looking Jewish Methodists. They're really worried, because you know the difference between Methodists and Presbyterians. Methodists will help you even when you don't want help. Presbyterians, I'm a Presbyterian, will say, you need money? I'll pray for you. What? What? Sorry, Lord. Sorry, Lord. So their trip gets interrupted. And I want you to think about this question. What would we lose if this passage were not in the Bible? What would we lose as people of faith if Luke chapter 7, verses 1 through 10 on page 65? Right? Of your pew Bibles. It's 10 verses. Luke chapter 7, verse 1. And following. Hear the word of God. When Jesus had finished saying all this in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum, a centurion servant whom his master valued highly was sick and about to die. The centurion heard of Jesus and sent some elders of the Jews to him, asking him to come and heal his servant. When they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him. This man deserves to have you do this, Remember, this is the leaders of the Jews. There's Pharisees, there's scribes, and they're speaking up for a Roman soldier, an occupier. Because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue, so Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith, even in Israel." Then the men who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well. In all of the New Testament, the one and only one person's faith that amazed Jesus was this centurion. He was amazed at the people from Nazareth. He was amazed at them because they didn't believe in him. But the word in the Greek scriptures that occurs twice, thaumatizo, means amazed. And the only person that it applies to is this goy, this army officer, this lowly Gentile, an occupier. Jewish leaders take the Romans' problem to Jesus, but take a look at Jesus' followers. They're standing around and they're going, "What is this?" You know, they want Jesus to take time to help this guy and this guy's servant. When he's an occupier, he's not a Jew. He doesn't have faith. He hasn't been with Jesus for all this time. You know, it just doesn't make sense. To them, the Roman centurion was a person on the perimeter. And I want you all to think about the people on the perimeter of your life. That maybe not so much deserve your prayers or even, you know, a finger snap worth of time for you to invest in their future because of what they've done, what they've said, how they treated your children, how they treated your family, how they treated you. But I want you to think about the people on the perimeter. May not be your enemy, but might be that you have some problems with. And this is who the Roman centurion represents to us as Christians today. People on the perimeter. Don't go to church. Don't read their Bible. Don't pray. Don't do nothing. So this soldier, he doesn't have the Holy Spirit. He hasn't been baptized. He just may be like some people we know. But we've got to put our arms around the fact that he has the faith that gets it. He amazed Jesus with his faith. He has faith that gets it. And we've got to wrap our arms around this. And we can, as we look into the scriptures and we look at his three requests. And from each of those requests, we're going to find a posture of heart that will help us in our faith. A posture of heart that this Roman centurion has that can help us in our walk with Jesus. So we'll look at these three requests, and that reveal three postures of heart from a soldier who stunned Jesus by his faith. What is this? I have my phone off. It's my birthday, I guess. It's my brother. What are you doing? Sorry. I hope they're not filming this. So the first request, help my friend, help my servant, intercessory prayer, help this person. Jesus, help this person. I can't. I'm at my wit's end. I've stubbed my toe. I'm worried out of my mind. I'm worried. Have you ever been so worried crazy? Just, gosh, I don't have anybody that can help. I can't help. I feel completely helped. I'm at my wit's end. And this is the point right there where grace comes in. This is where grace comes in our lives. Right at that strain where it says, I can't do nothing to help. I even have to take a step back. I even have to shut my big mouth. I got to take a big old serving spoon of peanut butter, put it into my mouth, and get it in there so I can't say a word. Because if I open my mouth, I'll just make things worse. So he asks for help. And this is the first posture of heart. Praying for others is a posture of a heart of a faith that gets it. Remember Job praying for his three friends? Remember the problem with Job? You know, God allowed terrible things in his life, and his three friends come to him, and they go, yeah. They didn't have any real empathy and compassion for Job, and that was their problem. So the Lord was going to singe their eyebrows, okay? The Lord's going to singe these three guys' eyebrows, and Job said, wait, Lord, wait. And Job interceded for them, and the Lord relented from punishing them, those know-it-alls, you know, those rational know-it-alls that know all the facts but have no empathy. That's where Job's friends came from. So intercessory prayer, Job praying for his friends. Remember when James says, you don't have because you don't ask. Remember the prophets? Remember the Lord. Remember the Lord. What he's done for you in your life. We can say that to ourselves today. Intercessory prayer is the work of a Christian. It's the work, and it takes work to pray for others. So praying for others is the first posture of heart. Centurion says, help my servant. He interceded. The Jews as a group interceded. The second request is this. Don't trouble yourself to come under my roof. Don't come. I'm not worthy. That's why I didn't come to you to begin with. He was a humble leader, this centurion. He was a bulwark of humble confidence. Sounds like an oxymoron, doesn't it? Humble and confident. A bulwark of humble confidence. He sent friends while Jesus was still off. And we remember when the prodigal's father was waiting for his young son, standing by, waiting. Neither the centurion in our story today, nor the father in the parable, nor Abraham with Isaac on Mount Moriah, panicked. This shows another posture of heart. You don't need to come under my roof. The posture of heart that refuses to panic. It's very hard sometimes not to fix it for our loved ones. We challenge ourselves to do something, even if it's wrong. But we as Christians can set conditions for trusting God by standing by in humble confidence and letting the Lord be Lord. Let me say that again. Refusing to panic is the second posture of heart, and it's undergirded by us through a tough-minded refusal to panic. Now, if you're an introvert, very rational person, you don't panic much. But you got people in your life that may be wired differently that you might have to help. But the posture of faith in the second request is, I am not going to panic. And when Paul says, I am content in all circumstances, well, sometimes I like to laugh at that and I get in trouble with the Lord. Yeah, right. Yuck it up, Lord. Yuck it up. This is, I can't understand why you have this. You're presenting this to me in my life. The third posture comes from the third request. But say the word and my servant will be healed. Say the word. The third request is submitting to the Lord's authority. A soldier's understanding of authority, submitting to God, it's important for us to see this, why God has this in the scriptures for you and me, this submission to authority. Now, I've known company commanders in my 26 years of active duty in the Army, and there's 5% of the soldiers in every company, and a company could be anywhere from 100 soldiers to 250 soldiers in large companies, and 5% of those soldiers take 95% of the commander's time because the main issue, they've got a problem with authority. The centurion submits to Jesus' authority. This is a deep current, a deep current. And behind this is even something deeper. And you can forget what I'll have to say about next, but if you don't want to, that's okay. The basis of this is me giving up my right to myself. The basis of submitting to Jesus is me giving up my right to myself. Whew, buddy, come on, chap. Ease up. Ease up. Tell us an illustration. Whoa. So this centurion deserves the Medal of Honor. He says, for I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell this one go and he goes. I tell this one to come and he comes. I tell my servant do this and he does it. And then Jesus, in response, out loud says, I tell you the truth. I tell you, I haven't found such great faith even in Yisrael. And just imagine who was standing around and listening to him. There are James and John and Peter, the inner circle, the other apostles, the women, Joanna and Susanna, who went with all the apostles and supported everybody. There's a group of people, and they just were stunned. This occupier's faith has amazed Jesus. Whoa. A New Testament pattern of getting it by centurions. Okay. Fasten your seatbelts. I only got about 3 more minutes of this sermon, so you can breathe a little easy, okay? Okay. This centurion really leads us in our faith. The three postures, the three requests, the three postures about our faith. Then there was a centurion at the cross. Surely, this is a righteous man. Then there was the third centurion in Acts chapter 10. He was the first Gentile believer who received the Holy Spirit, he and his family. Whoa, isn't that kind of counterintuitive to the share care and peace and love care and all that? I mean, soldiers that have this much impact on the teaching of the New Testament and the teaching that God has for our lives. Ooh, think about that. The Lord, let the Lord be Lord in your life, okay? That's my real concern today. Let the Lord be your Lord, your personal Lord. Your personal Lord. Let him be Lord. And you will be surprised. You might even say, you know, it's fun being a Christian. You might even say that. He's so counterintuitive. The Holy Spirit is so refreshing and so uplifting. Let the Lord be the Lord, and let the Holy Spirit just touch your life so that you can be salt of the earth that makes others thirsty to love Jesus more. You can be light of the world, and let the eyes, your eyes, the windows of your heart, display the love of Jesus that you don't even know about, and be, gladly be one of those 19 people that affect people for Christ that you don't know about. Gladly be his witness. Gladly. So, faith that gets it has three postures of heart. Intercessory prayer for someone, refusing to panic, and submitting to Jesus' authority. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Luke chapter 7. Go read it sometime today. Chew on it. Let the Lord bless you. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, I'm 8 minutes too soon. I've got to preach some more. Thank you, Jesus, for these people. Thank you, Jesus, for these people, these wonderful, kind people who've attracted my wife and I over these 8 years. Thank you for each congregation here. Thank you for how from how many faiths we come from. Greek Orthodox, Catholic, Baptist, Presbyterian, Methodist. Father, thank you. You have a special mission for us in this, the community that you have appointed for us to live and move and have our being. Use this story of faith as we walk with you, Lord Jesus. We thank you and praise you. In your name we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen, Brother Ben. Okay. Helen? Okay, Helen's waving. Yeah, back there. For God's goodness to us, each of us decides in our own hearts and our own minds what to return to the Lord. Let us worship the Lord. thank you for your smiles. Let's sing a hymn, number 593. Let's sing a hymn together. We're getting close, David. I don't have the book. I need the book.
Yeah.
I need the book. Okay. Yeah. All right. I want to give you the benediction, my favorite benediction from the scriptures. It comes from Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5. Receive the benediction. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Precious name.